Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Bomb and America's Missile Age by Christopher Gainor, narrated by Tom Perkins. Preface. The story of how the United States came to build Atlas and other first-generation intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBMs, begins in earnest in World War II and follows several strands over 9 years. To understand how the story of Atlas came to be distorted, this work also carries the story to the early 1960s to recount how the early days of the American and Soviet space programs affected perceptions of the creation of the first ICBMs. Chapter 1 describes the guided missiles that were created before and during World War II, including the German V-1 and V-2 missiles, and rocket programs in the Soviet Union and the United States before and during the war. The chapter ends with the creation of the first nuclear weapons and the first suggestions in the United States that they be married with missiles. To understand the Air Force's treatment of missiles in the years after the war, one must understand the changes it underwent during that time. Chapter 2 discusses the challenges facing the Air Force and the political and technological issues surrounding nuclear weapons in the late 1940s. Chapter 3 turns to the matter of missiles and how the branches of the U.S. military viewed them. Immediately after the war, scientists, engineers, and military leaders saw potential in several technologies, including jet engines, rockets, and nuclear propulsion, and the contest between the services for control of missiles was on even before the end of World War II. Rockets were just one type of missile, and both the United States and the Soviet Union moved slowly to develop them in the years following World War II. Chapter 4 tells how the U.S. Air Force started and then ended a program called MX-774, while the Soviets built a rocket replicating the German V-2 rocket. Chapter 5 profiles Vannevar Bush, who headed America's military research and development programs in World War II and the early post-war years. Bush questioned the need for long-range rocket missiles while exercising strong influence over their development. The year 1950 saw important decisions that ultimately led to the first U.S. ICBM, including President Truman's decision to develop thermonuclear weapons. Chapter 6's discussion of that year shows that U.S. policymakers were still focused on missiles designed to defend against Soviet bomber aircraft and missiles. As the Korean War and a massive increase in financial support for the U.S. military began in 1950, expert opinion in the United States started to shift in favor of rocket missiles, and as outlined in Chapter 7, the Atlas missile program began on a modest scale. American policymakers remained frustrated through this time over the lack of information about Soviet missile programs. Chapter 8 tells the story of how American and Soviet authorities approved programs to develop their first ICBMs, the Atlas and the R-7. Although both superpowers had undergone changes in 1953, the development of thermonuclear weapons was the crucial factor in the decisions in both countries. Once the two superpowers decided in 1954 to build ICBMs, both came face to face with their limitations as they built and deployed them, as outlined in Chapter 9. The first ICBMs also had second careers as space launch vehicles, as discussed in Chapter 10. Both chapters discuss the implications and the myths relating to the creation of the first ICBMs. This study also includes an historiographical essay on the history of Atlas that focuses on earlier works, whose arguments were based on suppositions from the early days of missile deployments and the space race between the United States and the Soviet Union. I have always been interested in the history of space exploration, and like many people, my interest was focused on the space race in the 1950s and 1960s that culminated in the first human flights to the moon. Little had been written on the years between the end of World War II and the preparations that began in the mid-1950s for the first satellite launches. I had written about the U.S. human space program of the 1960s and completed a master's degree in space studies at the University of North Dakota when Colin Burgess, who was editing a series for the University of Nebraska Press on the history of space exploration, commissioned me to write a book covering the steps leading up to the first human flights into space. My work on To a Distant Day, The Rocket Pioneers constituted my introduction to history of space exploration during the post-war years and to many of the issues that are covered in this book. Even before To a Distant Day was published, I began PhD studies in history at the University of Alberta. And as I cast around for a dissertation topic, Roger Launius, a former NASA chief historian then at the National Air and Space Museum, NASM, of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., suggested that the time had come for a fresh look at what led to America's first ICBMs, which related to the history of space exploration, because ICBMs also played major roles in the early days of both the American and Soviet space programs. That suggestion led to my PhD dissertation, which ultimately became this book. Introduction. The defining weapon system of the Cold War was the intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBM, topped with nuclear warheads. In the early years of this long struggle between the Soviet Union and the United States, the bomber aircraft carrying nuclear bombs was the primary weapon system, and as time went on, submarine-launched ballistic missiles gained an important place in nuclear arsenals. But from the time the United States and the Soviet Union began activating them in large numbers at the beginning of the 1960s, nuclear-armed ICBMs were the primary weapons in the standoff between the two superpowers. ICBMs built by both the United States and the Soviet Union were also quickly put to use launching artificial satellites around the Earth, space probes to the moon and planets, and the first humans into orbit. The race between the two adversaries to build ICBMs therefore powered the space race of the 1950s and 1960s. Today we are still living with the political, technological, and scientific effects of that Cold War competition. ICBMs were designed first and foremost to deliver nuclear weapons to distant targets in enemy territory. They offered high-speed delivery of these weapons, less than half an hour, to targets thousands of miles away. And even today, more than a half a century after their introduction, they are almost impossible to intercept once in flight. The ICBM represented the marriage of two technologies that were advanced during World War II, nuclear weapons and large long-range rockets. The story of the nuclear bombs these missiles were designed to carry has won far more attention from writers and historians than has the story of the missiles. One reason is the unprecedented destructive power of nuclear weapons. And another is that this power was used to great effect and great controversy when nuclear bombs were dropped from bomber aircraft on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 1945. These bombs were created by well-known scientists, many of whom came to disagree over how they should be used. And, so far, nuclear-armed missiles have never been used in anger. ICBM and nuclear weapons programs have always operated under a cloak of secrecy, which meant that they were not written about as much as higher-profile launch vehicles developed purely for space exploration. Atlas, America's first ICBM, was designed and built by the U.S. Air Force, USAF, which also built Titan ICBMs and the shorter-range Thor ballistic missiles at almost the same time. The first generation of ICBMs has a double identity that has caused a great deal of confusion among historians and others who have written about them. These early ICBMs also made superb space launch vehicles, and the two roles have often been confused in public discourse, starting with the idea that a rocket capable of launching satellites was automatically well suited to deliver nuclear weapons. for much of the four decades from the time of their creation to the end of the 20th century, most American satellites were launched atop derivatives of Atlas, the Titan II ICBM, or the Delta launch vehicle, which grew out of the Thor missile. The Soviet Union's first ICBM, the R-7, launched most early Soviet satellites and space probes, and uprated versions of the R-7 are still in use today, making it the workhorse of the Soviet and now the Russian space launch fleet. The R-7 lies at the heart of the story of the Soviet space program. Describing the place of Atlas in the history of America's space efforts is not so simple, and thus its roots have not been fully explored or explained. When the U.S. government launched its first artificial satellites, it used purpose-built satellite launchers from the U.S. Navy and the U.S. Army. Focusing on its mission to create an ICBM as quickly as possible, the USAF deliberately avoided making Atlas available as a space launch vehicle until it had proven itself for its primary mission. Both the United States and the Soviet Union began testing their first ICBMs in the spring of 1957. The first reported successful launch of an ICBM was the third test launch of the Soviet R-7 on August 21, 1957. 6 weeks later, on October 4, the same rocket was used to launch Sputnik, the first artificial satellite of the Earth, creating a worldwide media sensation. In November, an R-7 carried a dog into orbit, creating another media sensation. The Soviet Union went on to use the R-7 to launch the first object into solar orbit, the first spacecraft to reach the moon, and the first spacecraft to carry a human into orbit, along with other space firsts. The identity of the people responsible for the Soviet rockets and spacecraft remained secret for years, and the real story of the Soviet missile and space programs didn't fully emerge until after the fall of the Soviet Union in 1991. When the United States launched its first satellites in 1958, they flew on rockets that were far less powerful than ICBMs. Explorer 1, the first American satellite, was launched by the U.S. Army's team of rocket engineers after scientists and engineers tied to the U.S. Navy fell behind in their effort to launch a satellite. Successful test flights of the Atlas ICBM were obscured behind early failures and the successes of the Soviet R-7 as a space launch vehicle. Finally, in December 1958, when Atlas had been proven for its military purposes, the Air Force used it for the first time to launch a payload into orbit. In the wake of Sputnik, Democrats charged that Republican President Dwight D. Eisenhower had allowed America to fall behind its Soviet adversary. The American political crisis that followed Sputnik has long shaped historical descriptions of the Cold War competition between the United States and the Soviet Union over missiles and space exploration. Many Americans believed that the early Soviet successes in space, coupled with America's slower start, meant that the Soviets had a clear lead in the field of space technology. They also believed that the Soviet Union had become the first country to have an operational ICBM, leaving America in the unaccustomed position of being vulnerable to attack. Although Atlas suffered through a series of well-publicized problems in early test flights in 1957 and 1958, Soviet secrecy prevented outsiders from knowing that the R-7 also had troubles of its own in tests of its capabilities as a delivery system for nuclear weapons. The widespread American belief in Soviet missile superiority remained unchallenged through 1960, when Democrats claimed that the Eisenhower administration had allowed a missile gap to develop between the Soviet Union and the United States. By then, evidence obtained by U-2 aircraft overflights of the Soviet Union and, starting that summer, by Corona reconnaissance satellites showed that the missile gap vastly favored the United States. Eisenhower remained silent to protect his intelligence sources, even as his vice president, Republican presidential candidate Richard Nixon, lost narrowly to Democrat John F. Kennedy in the election that November. High-ranking officials in the newly installed Kennedy administration admitted early in 1961 that the missile gap was a myth. And that fall, they also proclaimed the clear American superiority in nuclear-armed ICBMs and bombers over the Soviet Union. Soon after Kennedy took office, the Soviets launched the first human into space. Discomfited by Yuri Gagarin's spaceflight and by America's failed invasion of Cuba at the Bay of Pigs a few days later, Kennedy responded by challenging American government, academia, and industry to land astronauts on the moon before the end of the 1960s. Kennedy and his successor, Lyndon B. Johnson, won the support of Congress for the moon landing goal, and the United States overtook the Soviet Union in the space race and landed the first humans on the moon in 1969. Despite the importance of ICBMs to the space efforts of both countries, and despite their place in the nuclear standoff that marked the Cold War, the origins of these missiles as delivery systems for nuclear weapons have often been glossed over or ignored in historical accounts. In the case of early U.S. missile and space exploration programs, histories were often built around Wernher von Braun, the engineer and manager who directed Germany's V-2 rocket program in World War II, then headed a team of German rocket engineers who worked for the U.S. Army from 1945 to 1960, and then joined the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, NASA, in the 1960s. Despite his work for America's enemy in World War II, von Braun emerged as a popular promoter of rockets and space exploration in 1950s and 1960s America. His Army team built a missile that was used as the initial stage for America's first satellite and then was used to lob two American astronauts on suborbital flights in 1961. Von Braun and his group spearheaded the creation of NASA's Saturn rockets that took American Apollo astronauts to the moon. As he increased his profile as a leader of America's space efforts, von Braun also worked with his friends and supporters to write influential early histories of rockets and space exploration that fostered the idea that space exploration was inspired by space pioneers who in turn inspired space enthusiasts in Germany, including von Braun and his team, and in America and the Soviet Union. Today, historians such as Michael J. Neufeld, Howard E. McCurdy, and Roger D. Launius are reassessing von Braun's place in the history of rocketry and space exploration, questioning many claims made by his supporters about the centrality of his role in 1950s U.S. space programs. This book seeks to free Atlas and other early U.S. ICBMs from the shadow of von Braun's oversized reputation. With historical and popular accounts of the birth of America's missile forces and space programs in the 1950s focused on von Braun's rockets, the Atlas and other Air Force missiles received relatively little notice. These missiles were developed by a government and contractor team headed by USAF General Bernard Schriever, using cutting-edge systems, engineering, and management techniques. In recent years, the story of Schriever and his team at the Air Force's Western Development Division has attracted interest among historians because of these production innovations. Once Atlas, Titan, and Thor proved themselves in test flights in 1958 and 1959, they were put into service, starting with Thor in 1958, Atlas in 1959, and Titan I in 1962. Atlas and Thor also began duty as the workhorses of America's space program, launching satellites into orbit and probes to the moon and throughout the solar system. In 1963, the USAF Titan II joined America's nuclear forces, and along with the Titan III rocket, it became an integral part of America's stable of space launch vehicles. Atlas launched the first four American astronauts to fly into orbit for Project Mercury in 1962 and 1963, and Titan II launched more astronauts for Project Gemini in 1965 and 1966. Although these missiles had relatively short lives as ICBMs, owing to their replacement by more effective solid-fueled Minuteman missiles, they remained as mainstays of the U.S. space launch vehicle fleet through the end of the 20th century. The question of why the USAF decided in 1954 to build an ICBM has received relatively little attention. As part of widespread political finger-pointing that followed the launch of Sputnik, the Air Force and the administrations of Harry S. Truman and Eisenhower faced strong political, media, and scholarly criticism for not starting on Atlas before 1954 and for not building it faster. This line of criticism lay behind the best-known and most influential historical analysis of the beginnings of America's ICBM program, Edmund Beard's 1976 book, Developing the ICBM, A Study in Bureaucratic Politics. Beard argued that the Soviet Union had defeated the United States in the race to develop the first ICBMs, and that the United States could have developed its first ICBM considerably earlier than it did, but waited until 1954 to begin its ICBM program while the Soviet Union began work on its ICBM in 1946. By the last decade of the 20th century, historians began to re-examine the space and missile races of the 1950s and 1960s in a new and more skeptical light. When the fall of the Soviet Union ended the Cold War in 1991, the veil of secrecy that shrouded Soviet missile and space programs was lifted at the same time as more information became available about American military programs. All this new information shed new light on what decisions were made about missiles and how and why they were developed. The new interpretations of this history are part of what Lanius has called the new aerospace history, which aims to move beyond concentration on individual rockets or spacecraft to wider social, political, and cultural issues relating to aircraft, missiles, and space vehicles. Many beliefs about Soviet missile programs that arose at the time of Sputnik were dramatically contradicted by evidence that came to light when Soviet archives were opened in the 1990s, especially the beliefs about the first Soviet ICBM that buttressed the arguments made by Beard and others about the superiority of Soviet missile programs. This book shows how Soviet secrecy and deception helped drive U.S. missile programs, while arguing that the ICBMs of both superpowers were created at the same time and for the same reason. In explaining how the U.S. Air Force came to its decision in the spring of 1954 to build the Atlas ICBM, this work extricates Atlas from the myths that followed Sputnik, with their claims that U.S. missile efforts were well behind those of the Soviet Union. To do so, this book argues that the Air Force and other military and political authorities had serious reservations about the possibilities of missiles as weapons during the years immediately following World War II. These reservations can be explained in part by the technical, organizational, and political issues that affected nuclear weapons, bomber aircraft, and missile programs. The decision to build an ICBM in 1954 came only after numerous advances in nuclear weapons and missile technologies, political changes in the U.S. government, and even a few technological blind alleys. Contrary to the popular belief fueled by Soviet propaganda that Soviet experts had begun developing ICBMs right after World War II, the Soviet government did not give the green light to creating an ICBM until 1954. Both the United States and the Soviet Union embarked on building ICBMs because of the creation of thermonuclear weapons in the 1950s that were hundreds of times more powerful than the first nuclear weapons, such as those used against Japan in 1945. Histories of the first ICBMs have often passed over this critical fact. While the requirements of Cold War nuclear weapons have usually formed the backdrop of narratives about the birth of the space technologies, they have rarely garnered the importance they deserve. The relationship between missiles and the nuclear bombs they were designed to carry lies at the center of this account of how the USAF decided to proceed with its first ICBM. Indeed, the technological advances that were necessary to move the technology of rocketry from the troubled V-2s of World War II to the much more sophisticated ICBMs of the 1960s were crucial to making human spaceflight possible, along with all but the smallest satellites and space probes. Without the nuclear confrontation between the Soviet Union and the United States in the 1950s, the history of space exploration would likely have been vastly different. To explain the Air Force's approach to missiles in the late 1940s and early 1950s, it is important to examine the state of the first delivery system for nuclear weapons, bomber aircraft, and the problems facing the branch of the USAF charged with delivering those weapons, the Strategic Air Command, SAC. The Air Force and the rest of the U.S. government had to operate within the political, economic, technological, and social constraints of the time, including tight budgets set for the U.S. military in the 5 years between the end of World War II and the start of the Korean War. SAC was poorly organized between the two wars, and bomber aircraft had to overcome many technical problems before they could deliver nuclear weapons to targets inside the Soviet Union. These issues have often been ignored by critics who saw Air Force leaders as overly devoted to their aircraft. To better illustrate the place of missiles in the USAF in the post-war years, this book examines the Air Force's struggle to win autonomy from the Army and its subsequent competition with the Army and Navy to control long-range missiles. The job of creating Atlas fell to the USAF after it bested the U.S. Army in a contest for control of long-range, land-based missiles. This is a notable fact because the first long-range ballistic missile, Nazi Germany's V-2, was built by the German Army, and the Soviet Union's R-7 ICBM was built under the supervision of the Army until the Soviet Strategic Rocket Forces were created in 1959. In the United States, winning control of the major delivery vehicle for nuclear weapons allowed the USAF to maintain control of nuclear weapons until the Navy created its force of submarine-launched ballistic missiles and the Army built tactical nuclear weapons and nuclear-tipped missiles designed to defend against enemy aircraft and missiles. As a result of Air Force control, America's ICBMs were designed and built by contractors with close ties to the Air Force, rather than being designed in-house by the U.S. Army. The evolution of ICBMs has exercised a powerful influence on the development of America's nuclear weapons and nuclear strategy, making this an important yet disregarded story. The Air Force also received outside advice on missiles, and this crucial part of the story is discussed here in far more detail than in previous accounts. As the USAF won its autonomy from the U.S. Army, it sought friendly sources of expert advice about new weapons through a scientific advisory committee and a private think tank with a limited degree of independence, the RAND Corporation. At the same time, the newly created Department of Defense attempted to establish control over the creation of novel military weapons through bodies such as the Research and Development Board and the Guided Missiles Committee. These bodies enjoyed little success in coordinating military research and development, with implications that went far beyond the matter of missiles. Long-range missiles quickly became a dual-use technology used for strategic nuclear weapons and to launch spacecraft into Earth orbit and beyond. The Soviet Union's space successes based on its first ICBM created incorrect perceptions of the military strength of the two major Cold War adversaries. The marriage of rockets with nuclear weapons was also necessary to move rocket technologies to the point where they could be exploited to carry humans and robots into space. Understanding how and why that marriage took place is essential to understanding the histories of both ICBMs and the space programs these rockets made possible. 1. Weapons of the Future. Early in the morning of June 13, 1944, An unusual flying vehicle, emitting a strange noise, crossed the English Channel from German-occupied France. It exploded upon impact in the village of Swanscombe in Kent, east of London, just 1 week after the first Allied troops had landed in France on D-Day. Later that day, three more of the strange winged craft crashed and exploded in southeast England. These were unpiloted aircraft equipped with what was then a new kind of power plant called a jet engine. Over the months that followed, the German Air Force launched thousands of these guided missiles against targets in Britain and Belgium. Each of these missiles, which the German government called the V-1, for the German word for vengeance, were 25 feet long, weighed 4,762 pounds, and were made up of a streamlined fuselage attached to stubby wings and the noisy jet engine that gave the missile its nickname, the Buzz Bomb. The German V-1 offensive also quickly led to Allied countermeasures, such as anti-aircraft guns, fighter aircraft, balloon barrages that reduced the missile's effectiveness, and an attempt to reverse engineer and replicate the V-1. But the German military was ready with another new weapon, which struck for the first time on the morning of September 8, 1944. The world's first long-range rocket missile, the V-2, crashed and exploded without any warning in Paris, near the Porte d'Italie, a little more than 2 weeks after the city had been liberated from the Germans. A few hours later, V-2s were launched toward London. The V-2 flew at a much greater altitude, 55 miles, at a far higher speed, 3,600 miles per hour, and had a far longer range, 200 miles, than the V-1 or any existing missile or artillery shell. The V-2 was the product of a highly expensive development effort led by the Ordnance Department of the German Army. No defenses could stop it once it was launched, and there would be no attempt to replicate the V-2 during the war because this missile marked such a major advance over anything that had been contemplated by United States or the other Allies. Even before these two weapons were first employed, British, American, and other Allied forces were aware that the Germans were working on advanced weapons, and Allied bombing campaigns against their development sites and planned launch sites had delayed their use by several months, according to General Dwight D. Eisenhower, the supreme commander of Allied forces in Europe. It seemed likely that, if the Germans had succeeded in perfecting and using these new weapons 6 months earlier than they did, our invasion of Europe would have proved exceedingly difficult, perhaps impossible, Eisenhower recalled a few years later. Neither missile succeeded in slowing the Allied advance, even when the Germans tried to disrupt the shipment of supplies to the Allied forces by bombarding the Belgian port of Antwerp with V-1s and V-2s. The missile attacks continued until March 1945, just weeks before Germany surrendered to the Allies in May. The introduction of the V-2 and smaller rockets, such as the tube-launched bazooka infantry rocket in World War II, marked the return of rockets to warfare after having been out of military fashion for nearly a century. Together with the jet-powered V-1, the forerunner of cruise missiles and military drones that came into use later in the 20th century, these rockets gained prominence as the first of a new type of weapon delivery system, guided missiles. World War II saw the introduction or advance of many technologies that meant big changes in how wars would be fought on land, on the sea, and in the air. This book focuses on guided missiles, and particularly on rockets, to explain how rockets came to be married to another new technology that did not come into use until the final days of the war. Rockets and jets. The appearance of the V-2 marked major changes in the field of rocketry that had been made in the years leading to the war, not by military inventors, but by creative people who worked to realize their dreams of flying into outer space. Before the 20th century, rockets had been fueled only with black powder, also known as gunpowder. Early in the 19th century, William Congreve and William Hale in Great Britain introduced technological changes that made rockets more reliable and accurate, increasing rockets' military utility. But that century also saw much bigger advances in other forms of artillery. Because rockets remained without any form of guidance after launch, they were largely sidelined from military uses in the 19th century and were used mainly to launch fireworks. Inspired by speculative novels about space travel written by Jules Verne, H.G. Wells, and others, people began to think at the turn of the 20th century about using rockets to carry humans into space. In 1903, an obscure Russian schoolteacher named Konstantin Tsiolkovsky wrote a paper suggesting that rockets using liquid fuels and oxidizers could fly far greater distances than gunpowder-based rockets. Although Tsiolkovsky's efforts remained in obscurity for years, others began thinking hard about using rockets to go beyond Earth's atmosphere, including Russians such as Friedrich Zander, whose work inspired other Russians to begin building rockets. Robert S. Nopertheris, a French aviation pioneer, independently developed many of the same ideas as Tsiolkovsky and began to publicize them. André Bing of Belgium obtained patents in 1911 for staging rockets. A school teacher from Transylvania named Hermann Oberth wrote a book containing technical details for a powerful rocket and a spacecraft capable of carrying humans, stirring up interest in space travel in Germany and Central Europe. In 1919, Robert H. Goddard, a physics professor at Clark College, later Clark University, in Massachusetts, published his ideas on solid rockets, including a suggestion that a rocket could fly to the moon. A press release in January 1920 from the Smithsonian Institution announcing this idea created a worldwide sensation. Goddard had worked for the U.S. Army during World War I on a small rocket, but that work ended unfinished with the 1918 armistice, and after the publication of his 1919 paper, he began a new independent line of research that led to the launch, in 1926, of the world's first liquid-fueled rocket. Contrary to popular belief, Goddard did not mind the sometimes critical newspaper coverage of his 1919 paper, but the practical New Englander was strongly concerned about the possibility that others might exploit his inventions without crediting him. Therefore, Goddard kept his liquid-fueled rocket research secret for 10 years, while enthusiasts in France, Germany, Russia, the United States, and elsewhere worked independently on liquid-fueled rockets that began to fly in the early 1930s. Goddard had begun his rocket development work in Massachusetts and continued it from 1930 to 1941 in New Mexico. After famed aviator Charles Lindbergh advocated on Goddard's behalf, philanthropist Daniel Guggenheim and his family financed Goddard's work, which included launching rockets up to an altitude of 9,000 feet. In 1941, Goddard went to work for the U.S. Navy. Other American rocket enthusiasts on the East Coast in 1930 formed the American Interplanetary Society, which later became known as the American Rocket Society, and some began building and testing rockets. A group of society members set up Reaction Motors Incorporated in December 1941, which won military contracts during and after World War II. On the West Coast, the Guggenheim Aeronautical Laboratory of the California Institute of Technology was formed under the leadership of Theodore von Karman, and in 1936, students and faculty there began work on rockets. The rocket project in the laboratory was transformed in 1944 into the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, while von Karman and others from the laboratory also formed the Aerojet Engineering Corporation, later Aerojet General. Both JPL and Aerojet won military contracts during the war to work on rockets. The two decades between the World Wars had seen little military research on rockets in the United States, and Goddard refused to share his findings with other American rocket researchers. The National Defense Research Committee, NDRC, a U.S. government agency set up in 1940 to sponsor military-related research, supported development of solid-fuel rocket engines that led to rockets launched by infantry and from aircraft and ships once the United States entered World War II. The NDRC began its rocket work in 1940 at the suggestion of Clarence N. Hickman of Bell Telephone Laboratories, who had worked with Goddard during World War I. Hickman was associated with the most famous product of the NDRC rocket program, the bazooka, which allowed infantry soldiers to fire against tanks. JPL researchers carried out some of the wartime NDRC rocket work, helping lay the foundation for JPL's work with solid-fuel rockets after the war. Soviet rocket research. Rocket and space travel enthusiasts in the Soviet Union had begun developing rockets and rocket engines starting in the late 1920s, and their activities came under control of the Soviet military in 1933. In the years leading up to World War II, Soviet rocket research was slowed by low levels of financial support and divisions between the researchers over priorities between solid-fueled, liquid-fueled, winged, and ballistic rockets. Stalin's great purges of 1937 and 1938, which decimated the ranks of the Soviet military and the Communist Party, are now considered to have not greatly affected Soviet rocket research because of the divisions and slow pace of research at the time. Several leading aircraft designers, such as Andrei and Tupolev, and rocket engineers, most famously Sergei P. Korolev, were swept up in the purges. And while both men survived the terror and the war, a few others were executed. When war clouds gathered in 1939, Tupolev, Korolev, and many of the skilled prisoners were put to work in prison-based design bureaus where they spent most of the war. The Soviet Air Force required fighter aircraft to stave off the Luftwaffe more than it needed bombers, so designs for Soviet long-range bomber aircraft languished during the war. The solid-fuel Katyusha artillery rockets were the best-known type of rocket used by Soviet forces during the war. As the war continued, Korolev and Valentin Piklushko, Russia's top rocket engine designer who had also been arrested, were allowed to shift from aircraft to rocket design, and in 1944 they were freed while they continued their work. In July 1944, British Prime Minister Winston Churchill wrote Stalin asking for help locating parts from a German V-2 ballistic missile that had crashed in Poland shortly before the Red Army overran the area. Stalin let British and American experts inspect the area, but only after his own forces had scoured it for V-2 parts. As the war came to its end and forces swept over the German Rocket Research Center in Peenemünde, aircraft and rocket experts were dispatched from the Soviet Union to assess the new German technology. German rocket research. In 1930, Wernher von Braun joined other German rocket enthusiasts in launching small rockets while he undertook studies for an engineering degree. In December 1932, the Ordnance Office of the German Army hired von Braun, marking the beginning of Germany's liquid-fuel rocket development program just a few weeks before Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of the German government. Under von Braun's technical direction, the growing German rocket organization built a number of rockets in a long and difficult development program, culminating in a rocket initially called the A4, which was launched successfully for the first time on October 3, 1942, at the German Army's Rocket Center at Peenemünde on the Baltic coast. This rocket, which became known to the world in 1944 as the V-2, was far more advanced than any other rocket built before it. It was the world's first ballistic missile, a rocket that flew briefly under power before following a ballistic path up to the edge of space and then back down to its target. During the war, the German Rocket Organization, which had grown to employ about 6,000 people, also carried out some preliminary development work on ballistic missiles that carried wings and more powerful engines to increase their range up to transatlantic distances. In 1943, the notorious Nazi paramilitary organization, the SS, Schutzstaffel, took greater control of the rocket program and employed slave labor from the Dora concentration camp to build the rockets at an underground factory at Nordhausen in the Harz Mountains in central Germany. As the Allied forces converged on Germany, von Braun and the leading members of his team, under orders from SS General Hans Kammler, drove to the Bavarian Alps, where they surrendered to American troops. Other American troops took control of the Nordhausen plant and its contents. The V-2 was remembered as a masterful advance in rocketry that opened the door to space. Weighing 14 tons and standing 46 feet high, the V-2 was much larger and more technically advanced than any other rocket that had come before it. But the V-2 was, in military terms, a boondoggle, according to Michael Neufeld, who has written the most thorough and balanced historical analysis of the V-2. The V-2 program cost about a quarter of the price of America's colossal effort to develop atomic bombs in the Manhattan Project, a sum that, if spent elsewhere, would have caused far greater damage to Germany's enemies. The 5,000 Allied civilians who died in all the V-2 attacks were a fraction of the deaths from single air attacks on Dresden, Hamburg, and other centers in Germany and Japan. The V-1, which cost far less than the V-2, created more terror among the Allies because of the noise it generated as it flew to its targets. And while the V-1 was eventually rendered ineffective because of countermeasures taken against it, those countermeasures cost the Allied forces far more resources than the V-2 did, because there was no defense that could be mounted against the V-2. Although this feature of the V-2 caused American, Soviet, and other militaries to desire similar missiles after the war, the V-2 was ineffective because it was inaccurate. In Neufeld's words, the V-2 could barely hit a giant city with any certainty. Because the V-2's electronics and navigation systems were not up to the job of directing the missile to a target, despite being the best available at the time, the V-2 was deployed too early to be an effective weapon. Despite the V-2's deficiencies, it contained great advances in the technology of liquid-fuel rockets, which carry both fuel and an oxidizer. Jet engines, which had appeared during the war in the form of the V-1 and small numbers of German and British jet fighters, burn fuel but require oxygen and therefore are limited to operating inside the atmosphere. But because jet engines carry only fuel and not an oxidizer, they are much lighter, less complex, and safer than rockets for use in crewed aircraft. At first, jet-powered missiles like the V-1 appeared to show greater promise to U.S. military leaders and engineers for long-range flights than rockets. The development of liquid-fueled rockets involved many technical challenges, including highly volatile fuels, designing fuel injectors, combustion chambers, and engine nozzles, maintaining stability as fuel drains out of the tanks, dealing with vibrations characteristic of rocket engines, and requiring high standards for all components in rockets, all of which added to their complexity and cost. There are many types of rockets, but the rockets that appeared in the 1940s and early 1950s were liquid-fueled rockets that used as an oxidizer liquid oxygen, which must be stored at extremely low temperatures. Alcohol was the fuel used in the V-2 and other early rockets, but more powerful fuels, such as kerosene, became more popular among rocket designers and builders in the 1950s. Later, rockets running on hypergolic propellant combinations that ignite on contact came into use. These propellants contain both fuel and oxidizer and can be stored at room temperature, but they are usually toxic and corrosive. Two key technological problems affecting ballistic missiles, such as the V-2 and others that followed the war, were the need for a guidance system to take the warhead to its target, and devising a means to protect warheads re-entering the atmosphere at the high speeds reached by these vehicles. Wartime missile programs in the United States. Rockets and jet-powered missiles were low on the U.S. military's priority lists during World War II, but not so low that the branches of the military didn't compete to control them. In general, the wartime missile development programs of the U.S. Army Air Forces, USAAF, had been limited to the development of weapons that planners hoped could be quickly built for immediate use. But they were hampered by a lack of central direction, adequate funding and facilities, and qualified staff. In 1943, responsibility for guided missiles within the air staff had been given to the air communications officer until shortly before the end of the conflict. Although this officer, Brigadier General Harold M. McClelland, held a high rank, he was already burdened with many unrelated responsibilities, as his job title indicates. When researchers from Caltech proposed developing rocket engines for the military in November 1943, the USAAF turned down the idea, but the U.S. Army Ordnance Department signaled its interest. In January 1944, Army Ordnance asked Caltech to begin work on what became the solid-fueled private and liquid-fueled corporal rockets under the ORDSIT, Ordnance, California Institute of Technology, program, along with a smaller version of the corporal for scientific work called the WAC Corporal. On November 15, 1944, Army Ordnance signed a contract with the General Electric Company to conduct a rocket and guided missile development project called Hermes, which had the aim of using captured German technology to develop guided missiles and associated technologies. The propulsion technologies included rocket engines and ramjets, a type of jet engine that appeared to hold promise for high-speed aircraft and missiles. A month after the first V-1 attack in June 1944, one of the German jet-powered missiles landed intact in southern England. This intelligence gift to the Allied forces was quickly handed over to officers from the USAAF. They quickly transported the craft across the Atlantic to their research facilities at Wright Field in Dayton, Ohio, for close examination. Within weeks, the secrets of the V-1 had been revealed, notably that of its pulse jet engine. Work began on reverse engineering the V-1 and manufacturing an American version, which became known as the JB-2, or the Loon, marking the beginning of the USAAF's guided missile programs. After the defeat of Germany, the USAAF's development work on the JB-2 missile continued with the idea that it could be employed against Japan. The U.S. Navy, for its part, initiated several guided missile programs during the war, including an adapted version of the JB-2 for launch from aircraft carriers and submarines. It even contracted the Applied Physics Laboratory at Johns Hopkins University to study anti-aircraft missiles and a long-range bombardment missile. The USAAF chafed at the missile programs begun by the Navy and Army Ordnance, but it pressed on in 1945 with the JB-2 missile, and, more importantly at that time, with other means of bringing Japan to its knees. The atomic bomb. In the Pacific War, the USAAF had bombed 60 Japanese cities with incendiary bombs between March and July 1945, laying them to waste, killing hundreds of thousands of people, and weakening Japan's ability to fight. The United States and its allies were preparing for an invasion of the Japanese islands starting later that year. In July, President Harry S. Truman met in Potsdam with his British and Soviet counterparts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.